like to welcome Justin Cooke, the CMO of Topshop, to the stage. A few people have probably heard of Topshop here, he's going to tell us all about Topshop and probably some other things.
Cool. Amazing day. Thank you so much. Excited to be here. Some great people. It's always when you're in the last slot, you always think everyone's just going to desert the room and no one's going to watch you, whether it's a compliment or not, but I will try and keep it tight and exciting. Just going to basically talk to you very, very loosely about Topshop and some of the things that we're thinking about for about a minute and 20 seconds, do not time it. And then I'm going to talk about other things which kind of inspire me personally, where I've come from, and maybe some of the things that have led us to think the way we're thinking. So, first thing that you hopefully will have seen is our show, which gave us a lot of coverage. It was very exciting. We tried to do something which hadn't been done before in this space. We think we have a very, very interesting customer base. Probably only Nike or Apple can talk to the same demographic as us. We play so broad, and we have a very, very digital kind of, you know, connected customer. And this, we really wanted to. So the season before I arrived, we had about 50,000 views across a week on the Topshop Unique show. Topshop Unique is our kind of most aspirational point of the brand. So we looked at this and said, okay, we've got millions of people coming into topshop.com. Instead of taking it to all the other social platforms, let's bring all the social platforms into our space, because then you've got the traffic and you know people have the behavior. So we created something we think was quite unique, which is very fitting for the show. We worked with Facebook to develop technology, so when you were watching the show, you could click this button here, and it was kind of loosely inspired by the iPhone, you know, where you take a screenshot. Hopefully you can all do that of your own phone. But it just meant that people could watch the experience and share it immediately on Facebook through, you know, with all their fans. And anything that you touched in the experience automatically posted on your page saying, Justin just customized the catwalk, Justin's listening to the music on topshop.com. So really, you know, really using kind of prevalent technology, but making it simple. And we allowed users to customize during a live show, which has never been done before. And we thought it was really cool. We were inspired by car companies. You know, look at Nike ID, bringing that into a live environment for me was very interesting, because Nike will tell you that they get tens and tens of thousands of people designing, playing with that shoe. Maybe they don't buy it, maybe they do. They send it to their friends, they post it on their page. And I think that behavior for us is what's interesting, looking at how people engage with your content. You know, if you get that mind share, you will eventually get the market share. And I think it's an important part. You know, you can't look always for immediate return, but we did sell a lot of stuff as well. and we went to Apple and kind of said, look, you know, everyone always wants to take the music away. It's like a classic fashion thing. It's like, what's the music on the show? And you're like, okay, just, you know, the most prevalent place to get music is iTunes. Everyone has an account. And I think something also quite beautiful about taking a piece away with you from the Topshop show. So all this is set up to say, not everybody wants to watch the show. Not everybody wants to watch the video. Some people want to share the look. Some people want to play with products. Some people want the music. Some people just want to talk about it. So I think, you know, we gave the user the control. And we pulled Twitter in as well. And kind of challenge people, you know, in a competition in 140 characters to review the show, and the best person wins tickets to the next show. So again, bringing that digital and the physical together, so they were connected, and all the beauty could be bought immediately. So the sales of beauty were phenomenal compared to what we normally sell on a Sunday. It was, you know, enormous, because people felt like they were buying a piece of the runway. It's a very affordable product. So we think that it's an interesting thing that we're going to build on. I did show this to Will.i.am before we launched it, and he looked at me for a while, didn't say anything, went, that's dope. And I thought that was quite cool, because actually he said to me, think if this was a music, you know, if this was a live, like, you know, Black Eyed Peas event, and you had, you know, the Black Eyed Peas there, and you could buy the t-shirt from the thing, you could download the album. I mean, that, it is quite, we like to think, quite cutting edge. So that was kind of what we were shooting for. People were very impressed with it. I will show you something at the end that talks about what actually happened, but I'm not going to talk about it right now. If you were following us this week on Twitter and Instagram, we launched a competition which we thought was very cute called Trick or Tweet. One of the girls in my team coined it, and it was just, you know, it was really about just creating extra engagement. So there was over 50,000 tweets, retweets, comments about what we're doing. But what we really loved was, you know, the standard of what people were doing. They were sending in the Halloween outfits, inspiring other people to think about how it. So Demi Lovato did one, had 10,000 retweets, insane. She's on the X Factor, if you don't know. You know, but it's like, it's just, you know, people are really, really pushing the boundaries. So it's like customer competition. You know, people were talking about gamification earlier. I think, you know, when you give that to the customer, all of this is about bold communications. If you go on the New York Times, they'll share an article from The Guardian, they'll share you something from the FT. They don't mind, because they know the more open they are as a brand, the more you come back to them for content. It's not about saying, you will only read our content. So this is really part of that experience, about sharing with everyone. We even got the CEO of Twitter to come down and get involved. Philip met him. He almost thought about tweeting, but Dick couldn't convince him. So it's just Topshop for now, you'll be pleased to know, but you never know in the future. And, you know, I think, again, it's just about every month we want to do something fun. It's not about trying to change the game or reinvent the world. It's just about doing things that our customer appreciates. That's what we're looking for, is just, you know, to give them some fun things to do, and I think it worked. But I know there's lots of people talking about all the tech things they're doing and everything. I'm not going to put everything up here, because we're doing a lot of stuff. We have a scanner on Apple already, just want to say. But it's, you know, it's really, for me, it's, I think what everyone has to really get to grips with is don't just do it for the sake of doing it. We're testing a lot of stuff. We're doing buy online, click in store. We've got iPads in our new store so that people can buy if they don't want to go in and look around. This is very useful for us because we're, you know, we create this kind of phenomenal excitement around product launches. So people, you know, queue around the block to get into our store. And I think this offers a customer that doesn't want to queue the opportunity to buy something and, on a day of a launch and get it delivered to their home, which for me is, again, it adds a value. Some people actually love being in that melee. So, you know, you've got to have both of those things. But it's about doing stuff that's really meaningful, and I'll come on to that. So that's the end of Topshop, literally, but in this presentation. What I'm here to talk to you about is digital emotion, which Angel from Westfield said earlier you couldn't do. So thank you for teeing me up nicely, because you can. And it's really about these things that I think about. So when I look at experiences, I think about all the kind of pieces to that puzzle. And I think increasingly you have to do everything. People probably only think about the last two, and they don't always do them that well. And the customer is much wiser than that. I think I should also say that there's no such thing as an expert anywhere in the world. Everybody's learning. It's an incredible time. So reports of me being a guru are overhyped, but I do enjoy them. You know, we have to be, you know, realistic. It's the most incredible time. I think when people look back, they will talk about Facebook and Twitter and Google in much more glowing terms. It's a massive, massive shift. It's a revolution that people don't always acknowledge because we're living in it. And I'm really so fortunate. I'm 30 years old. I'm doing a job that I love, and I'm really, you know, there's a great quote which is that you're kind of made up of the people that you're around. So when I was 18, I was a runner in Tom Ford's office in the day when he was kind of very famously saying, we don't even have enough money to put ink in the photocopier, and he turned the whole brand around. I then moved to Stella McCartney, which was bought by the Gucci Group, and it was a startup essentially, and you know, you kind of had to be a publicist and a thing, and she'd be like, go meet my friend, and it'd be like Gwyneth Paltrow, you're like, okay, that's not your friend, that's Gwyneth Paltrow. But you know, you kind of, you learn from all these things that you're around. And then I was so lucky, I joined Burberry, I was there for 5 years, you know, 5.5 years, literally I joined 2 months after Angela Arendt joined. Most incredible, incredible woman you will ever meet. She should definitely run for President of America. She has such power and such awe, but she also has just this incredible understanding of people and how to connect, you know, things. And I think when you see that, you know, I didn't hear her shout once in 5 years. I mean, she's just like, you know, when you think the pressure of running a business like that and the dramatic change that company went through, you know, the learning was incredible. And I was so lucky to work closely with Christopher on pretty much everything. And so I kind of had this incredible position where I learned all the things and the way that they wanted. And it was my job to communicate a lot of what we were doing to the media. So I feel like I was in a very privileged position. And all this stuff in the world that is, you know, everyone's here talking about and excited about. You know, when I was 18, 19, that was kind of, you know, we were the kind of guinea pigs for this, and it was the exciting thing. And, you know, like, you had to have the newest thing, the newest Nintendo. I remember when I got my first Sega Master System, and I was so excited, and then I found out my brother got a Nintendo, and it was like, what? I got completely stiffed. So, it's, and I think you'll see when I come to it later, that competition element is important, you know, that you want to know about the newest, the most exciting, the most innovative technology, but then you need to think about how and if it's relevant to you. I'm going to show you a quick thing on education, because I'm going to talk to you about how uneducated I am, and this is not to offend anyone in university who's been or has great qualifications.
Every country on earth at the moment is reforming public education. There are two reasons for it. The first of them is economic. People are trying to work out how do we educate our children to take their place in the economies of the 21st century. How do we do that? Given that we can't anticipate what the economy will look like at the end of next week, as the recent turmoil is demonstrating. How do we do that? The second, though, is cultural. Every country on earth is trying to figure out how do we educate our children so they have a sense of cultural identity and so that we can pass on the cultural genes of our communities while being part of the process of globalization. How do you square that circle? The problem is they're trying to meet the future by doing what they did in the past. And on the way, they're alienating millions of kids who don't see any purpose in going to school. When we went to school, we were kept there with a story, which is if you worked hard and did well and got a college degree, you would have a job. Our kids don't believe that. And they're right not to, by the way. You're better having a degree than not, but it's not a guarantee anymore. And particularly not if the route to it marginalizes most of the things that you think are important about yourself. Some people say we have to raise standards as if this is a breakthrough. You know, like, really, yes, we should. Why would you lower them? You know, I haven't come across an argument that persuades me of lowering them.
So I won't play the whole thing, but you should definitely check it out. Sir Ken Robinson, and it's a very interesting thing for me because I left school when I was 18, and he goes on to talk about this whole thing, basically about, you know, when you're up to the age of about 10, your genius ranking is off the chart. You're in the 90 percentile, and as you get older and you get more educated, you lose that genius. And, you know, it's just a really, you know, it doesn't apply to everyone, but for me personally, I'm not saying I'm a genius. I'm just saying that, you know, there's something about learning just naturally in the world that stops you from thinking that there's only one or two answers. And I think, you know, the stuff that I had left over is probably what drives me to what I do. And I think my mother passed away when I was about 18, 19. I'm not saying that for sympathy, I'm saying it because I think it heightened my emotions. I think it changed the way that I see things. And I think that I put that into my work, and it's kind of something that really fascinates me. So when I was at school, I absolutely hated pretty much everything except for English literature. She was the only teacher that was nice to me. And I think what's fascinating, is, and including that video, is that when you look at content that is compelling, that is moving, that is emotive, you automatically have so much more of a connection to it. You pay much more attention, you're much more engaged. This is one of the best-selling ever sets of DVDs, downloads, whatever you want to call it. The Discovery Channel, I'm sure you can all confess this, I will watch a volcano program for at least an hour now, because they just do it in the most incredible, beautiful way, and the narration and everything. And I think it's a really important thing. When you think about that with a brand and you think about products, it's something important that you need to remember. And it's kind of led me to all these different kind of influences, and I sort of read books about, like, I read about three pages, I can read, just so you know. But I read like three pages and then I get bored. But I take little bits away, little sound bites, and I think, you know, this guy's amazing. He talks about, he goes into Apple and looks at, you know, the reason why you're so connected to them, because everyone goes, oh, they're brilliant, you know. But it's more than that, you know, they put so much behind their brand, and I'll talk about that later. And when I joined Burberry, I would say it was pretty much as a, you know, if you looked across everything, content, the way the brand was thinking, advertising, it was so print heavy. And we really looked at the content journey and how we could bring people closer. We thought about, you know, device and channel and how people were accessing the brand. And I think we started to ask ourselves questions. You know, Christopher had this incredible vision for the company and how we wanted to evolve it. And he was talking always about keeping that heritage but modernizing it. And I think, you know, when we got to the launch of Art of the Trench, it was really a game changer for the brand, because it was the first piece of digital content that went out in the world that was exactly the way the brand wanted to be seen. And I think that's what changed everything. You know, it didn't live in an environment that was on Burberry.com. Burberry.com was like 2 years away from being overhauled. And so this was a place, you know, our strategy was to iconize the trench coat. And you couldn't really have done anything better. This brought together all the storytelling, you know, people passing their coats down from generation to generation. It was shareable, it was beautiful, it was visual. You know, we launched it with Scott Schumann, the sartorialist. So we made sure there was that filter, you know, of the quality of the imagery. So you wouldn't just get people sending any old thing. It was like you actually had to live up to one of the top, you know, bloggers at the time, and still now. So I think that was a really exciting point in time for us, and it generated huge coverage, and of course that was really the beginning of everything. And this is one of the things that I actually loved, because it was a quote that came out afterwards, and I think the point is that anyone can do this stuff. You just have to look at the soul of your brand. You have to look about, you know, what you're doing and what the message you're putting out there is, because anyone can still do this, but you just have to, you have to do it with thought and with purpose and with emotion. Not everybody liked it, though, I have to say. And I'm a huge fan of Miuccia Prada. But the last line, I think, is especially, it could be one that comes back to bite her, because I don't think that one is going to be right. But the point is as well, is I think people, especially in luxury, are still a little bit scared of it. There's a lot of brands that you look at that aren't online, they don't have an online business. And I think, like the points that were made earlier, there's still a kind of misconception that you can't keep the same elevated positioning, that you can't keep that emotion, that physical experience that you can get. And I disagree with that, because I think you can absolutely create it. And actually what I became obsessed about was not the coat, it was the feeling behind the coat. And so I used to, you know, these are things I used to send to my team and get people to think about. You know, it's something much more powerful than that, because nobody needs anything really. You have to make them want it. This is the way, like, I used to send this to my people and just say, like, you think about, like, the storytelling, you know, what's the moment around the product, like, you know, what's that little piece of conversation, and this is something that we found that we sent as inspiration, like, listen to this 1 second, I'll tell you what it is, hopefully you'll get it before I say anything. It's a Slovenian choir. Digital emotion. that's pretty amazing. You know, that's like, you know, I heard someone say earlier, you can't create that kind of stuff digitally. You can't, if you're online and you're not in the show, you won't feel it. My God, you'd feel that. You would be completely touched by that. And I think that's the kind of stuff you have to push yourself and challenge yourself to think about. And I love stuff like this because it's true. It's like, you know, I will be standing up here talking loads of rubbish and you'll leave, but, you know, but maybe you'll remember, you know, how I made you feel or what I made you think. And I think that's important because you can do that with your content, you can do that with your brand, and you can do that with your experiences. And when you think about what that looks like across everywhere, you know, if you look at great advertising, I mean, The Economist, you know, it's a genius publication. It's about intelligent thinking. That is a useless piece of outdoor advertising, but they have made it so perfect for their brand that you look at that and you just think genius and you probably go and buy a copy. Apple can basically put anything on a billboard and we buy it, let's face it. And Nike, you know, every time Nike puts something up there or if I walk in their store, I feel immediately like I'm a world-class athlete. And that's part of the experience that they put around it. You know, all the little things like hashtag make it count or just little moments that they create. You feel like everyone dreams of being, you know, a pop star or a sports star. And when they tap into that emotion underneath you, you know, you believe it even just for a minute. This is a great piece of advertising that maybe you all saw, but when Honda launched this, their sales spiked significantly, you know, and what they were looking for was to change the way people thought about their brand. They wanted to be seen as innovative. So they took all the parts of a car that was one of their cars and made, you know, this beautiful trail of kind of content. You know, it was hugely viral. It was like tens and tens of millions of people. Their sales spiked. They didn't follow it up. That's the thing. You've got to follow stuff up as well. But, you know, really beautiful thing. They say this is one take. I don't know if it's true, but it ends with the car starting. And I think, you know, when you start layering stuff around that, so music for me is absolute killer. You know, you can take people down with music in a second. But if you really think about the music that goes with the content and make it into this really compelling thing, I think you can really get to people. This is a tea advert that hopefully you all saw for Twinings. Twinings, I think, so.
My life and love might still go on in your heart and your mind.
Really beautiful piece of content, really touchy, absolutely perfect for the target market. You know, mothers at home drinking tea, thinking they can float away into this magical world. They got me too. But, you know, it's just, I think it's important. You know, they really thought about their customer. And that song, you know, went hugely viral on their YouTube link. They put a download. It was a song that was already very successful on the Tunes store, and they got someone to cover it. And then they sold hundreds and hundreds of millions of the track. And I think they were probably on an affiliate deal as well, which is smart. This is a great piece in the Wall Street Journal that actually explains why you get that emotion. There's a word here that if anyone can say it, you can definitely have money, because I've even Googled it and I can't work it out, but it's like an apogeratura. But basically the point is it create, you know, great songs, the ones that really, you know, affect you. And this is particularly talking about someone like you, which is dangerous around anyone. It, you know, it has these moments basically of tension and then it resolves it for you. And I think that is, again, you know, when I pick a song for something, I really think about it. Is this meant to be fun? Is this meant to be energetic? What's the message that we're trying to put across under that content? And actually on the weekend I was posting something on Instagram, and I think our expectations have changed. You know, we're pushing more and more for these multiple experiences, and I wanted that picture to have the song that I hashtagged underneath with it, which is a really beautiful track about autumn leaves, and I wanted everyone to feel what I was thinking. So I'm going to try and develop that. But it's, you know, it's just, you know, there are bits and pieces of it. SoundCloud are doing things, and again, but I just think you can make things so magical for people. And when you think about when you're telling stories, you know, there's so many different channels now, so you have to think about what it looks like in each of those places. Everyone talked about mobile today, which is great, and it's absolutely important. These guys have known it for a long time, and they've been very smart about it, but I think it's a really powerful point that, you know, basically you go to sleep, if you're like me, your phone is never, ever more than actually about 15 centimeters away from you. It's always in your pocket, you probably charge it next to you, and so we can all reach you all the time, but as that happens more and more, we have to be more thoughtful about what we reach you with, and that goes back to that piece about scheduling and rhythm. You can't, you know, just, if you keep bombarding people, it's like when you get too many emails, you just delete them, and then you go, how can I unsubscribe now? Quickly. So, you know, keep that in mind. Steve Jobs said this about 15 years ago, and I think this is a big part of what I think about when I'm thinking about consumer journeys. Like, you know, it doesn't begin and end when you make the purchase. It's got to be more than that. It's got to be further than that. And actually, people talk about Apple, but when you look at it, you know, everybody, they have very bold communications. They iconize their product in a way like nobody can, but you can. You know, they have incredible expertise, they're genius bars, you can go in, you always feel like you can get help with anything, any device they have. And actually, once you've made the purchase, once you've bought your iPhone, once you've bought your laptop, that's when the journey starts. And then you're in control, you can add your apps, you can download things, and it becomes this incredible, you know, ongoing journey. They actually call their office the infinite loop, and no one's ever talked about it to me, but when I went there, I was like, this is basically like a joke on everyone, isn't it? Because that's how you think about the customer. It's like, you know, you keep them in that cycle. You know, if this was a conference 10 years ago, someone would have put a slide up with a straight line of the customer journey. And I think it's that circle, and their service proposition is second to none, but you're also in control of it again. And you know, when you think about their content, I will spend hours looking at this. I also go on this blog called Things Organized Neatly, where they basically, I have a tiny bit of OCD, but you know, they put stuff in these incredible orders, and you know, like, you will look at that for ages. It's just fascinating. It's like, I don't even know what any of those parts do, but it's just beautiful. And you know, again, it's an amazing piece of content. I'm not going to say who, because it's this press here, and I don't know who he said this to exactly, but apparently, allegedly, Steve Jobs was in the room with a big mobile operator. And they, you know, it was in the beginning of the iPhone days, and he was talking to them, and they were negotiating contracts, and they were like, no, we're not going to let you have, you know, exclusivity or whatever. And you know, he basically stormed out of the meeting, allegedly, and said this. And I think it's really, you know, he knew way before anyone else, like, everyone was making these like bricks and, you know, all these things, and he was like, it doesn't matter, because I'm going to put the content into the device. It's not going to be about the device. And by the way, we're going to make the best devices as well. And then if you look behind Jonathan Ive and the stuff that he says, and he very rarely says stuff, but you can find it, you know, he's a very incredible guy. I actually saw him speak at the RCA, and he was just so, you know, humble and incredible. But he also, his teacher had said before that his design project when he was at university was a hearing aid, and his whole objective was to make that hearing aid less visible, you know, more like thinking about the person that was wearing it. And it's just like, it's so thoughtful, and that's the way that he approaches design. It doesn't surprise me at all. And this is a little video that they released when Steve Jobs passed away, which I think the quote at the end is something that, you know, really resonates with me, because it's about, you know, that thinking about what it really means when you're using technology.
There's an old Wayne Gretzky quote that I love. I skate to where the puck is going to be, not where it has been. And we've always tried to do that at Apple. This is iMac. The whole thing is translucent. You can see into it. It's so cool. This amazing little device holds 1,000 songs, and it goes right in my pocket. An iPod. A phone, and an internet communicator. Are you getting it?
Good morning, well, can I help you?
Yes, I'd like to order 4,000 lattes to go, please. No, just kidding, wrong number, thank you. It's in Apple's DNA that technology alone is not enough. It's technology married with liberal arts, married with the humanities, that yields us the result that makes our hearts sing.
So, you know, I think that's important. I'm going to skip through a little bit because I know we're running short on time, but, you know, basically, there's a lot of crazy stuff going on in the world. I think it's an incredibly exciting time. Talking about crazy, hopefully you all saw this. You know, great tweet. You know, the point is that we're accessing this content in a completely different way. And, you know, we're pushing ourselves to completely new places. And I actually think it's the most unbelievable time, because it's probably the first time where our dreams, our crazy ideas, our imagination has actually been met or exceeded by technology. And so the kind of, you know, the realms are really like unlimited. And this is a quote from Velocity, which is Jazz's book, Jazz Ahmed, and is someone who's very inspiring to me at the moment. And I think it's so true, it really struck a chord with me, that this is the time where you can do the most unbelievable things. And we believe we have that Topshop. I think that, you know, like the kid who's a genius before they learn too much, I think everybody has the opportunity in them to be a great brand, and it's just about how you elevate it. Thank you.